anything I say here, a lot of people might take wrong. But I'm going to say you're darn right I opened the doors. I kicked open a lot of those doors. And if they don't want to give me credit for it, that's fine with me. I know in my heart what I done. So I know I kicked those doors open for Loretta and Tammy and even Patsy for that matter.
Patsy Cline was initially attracted to the rough and ready lifestyle of the honky-tonk, and she and her husband were regulars in the bars of Nashville.
I go out walking after midnight.
She wasn't too animated on stage, but when she sang a heart song, well, you listened close and you knew at that particular time she was living that song.
After midnight. But despite her ambitions to sing with grit like Gene Shepherd, Patsy Cline's voice made her the perfect performer for the new wave of smooth country pop.
Something about Patsy Cline, her voice really, really just had a sense of immediacy to the listener and that they could relate to her.
All the songs, I think, whether it fit her life or not, she tried to make it sound like it did. And one night she was recording, and I didn't realize she was doing all old tearjerkers and fresh sad songs. And I walked in the studio, and Owen Bradley called me in the control room. He was Patsy's producer, and said, "Did you and Patsy have a fight tonight before she came down here?" I said, "No." He said, "Well, I want you out of here." And I said, "Well, what have I done?" "You haven't done anything, but Patsy's crying on every song. I don't want to break the mood, so you get the hell out of here." Because she was actually, tears was actually running down her cheeks while she was singing.
Maybe he's crying for me. And as the sky turns gloomy, night wind.
Her voice was just so extraordinary. I mean, she could really sing anything. So I think that she was kind of pushing the envelope on country music a little bit. So that people start thinking about country music in not maybe such a narrow parameter.
Patsy Cline had the perfect voice for what became known as the Nashville sound. Country music had had the stuffings kicked out of it by the rise of rock and roll in the 1950s, and in order to win listeners back to country, they had to downplay the steel guitar and the banjo and the hillbilly aspects of it, and upplay the heart in it. And that's what Patsy had, was an enormous capacity for delivering a lyric with heart.
Crazy, I'm crazy for feeling so lonely.
She had a sexiness about her and an energy about her. Her personality came through, so she, that sensual quality that she had, I get that. When I hear her records, I can just hear her, how sexy she was and the way she sang her songs. And I think that encouraged other women to do the same.
As you wanted.
At first, Patsy Cline had resisted country's move into pop, and when presented with a Willie Nelson ballad, she struggled to put her own stamp on it.
Crazy was, they did one whole session on Crazy and didn't get it. But I think the reason she didn't get it because she had a Willie Nelson demo, and Willie talked a song as much as he sang a song, and she was trying to do it like the demo, and it just didn't happen. Somebody said, "Well, why don't you forget Willie and just sing it the way you feel like?" And went back and one or two takes and was cut.
The result became one of country's signature songs.
I don't think it will ever sound out of date, really. A little bit jazzy, a little bit sophisticated, and yet with a roots center. That stuff never really goes away.
Crazy for thinking that my love could
Though Patsy Cline died in a plane crash along with Hawkshaw Hawkins, Gene Shepherd's husband, on their way back from a gig in 1963, she became a bigger star in death than she ever was in life.
I think no matter where she would have gone in the music business, her home would have been country. And I think Loretta, when Loretta came to town, Loretta talks about her having an influence on her.
I think in the 60s you had three women who really set a standard, raised the bar, as it were, to a new level. And those three women were Loretta Lynn, Tammy Wynette, and Dolly Parton. They all came along roughly in the mid-60s, Loretta first. And Loretta, in many ways, kind of set the pace.
Loretta Lynn was raised in a poor rural community in Kentucky. She launched her career with a legendary tour that typified her gritty determination. With barely the money to pay for gas, she and her husband drove thousands of miles across America, calling in on the nation's local radio stations to promote her first single, I'm a Honky Tonk Girl, which she wrote herself. The couple survived 3 months by sleeping in the car and living off a diet of bread and bologna, a feat that was repaid when the record hit the country charts.
Honky Tonk Girl was my first record. Yeah. Nobody could get it, but the disc jockeys played the devil out of it, and they put it in the top 10. So I was real happy. I like to know my disc jockeys. I think they're part of your career. And if you didn't have them, where would you be?
This intuitive ability to stay in touch with her market was one of the cornerstones of Loretta Lynn's career. As the decade progressed, she openly reflected the changing roles of women in the 60s in material that for the first time was largely self-written.
When you hear, you ain't woman enough to take my man, and when you hear the squaw is on the warpath tonight, you know that she's lived every word of that. She wrote all those songs and she lived it.
Loretta was the hillbilly feminist. She wasn't going to be ashamed of who she was, from her femininity to her socioeconomic status in life. She was poor but proud. She was a woman but proud. And that comes through in song after song after song after song. And women loved her for it. And she, more than anyone, proved women do by other women. Who do you think bought Loretta Lynn? Men? I don't think so.
You thought that I'd be waiting up when you came home last night. You'd been out with all the boys and you ended up half-tied. A liquor and love, they just don't mix, either bottle or me behind. And don't come home a-drinkin' with lovin' on your mind.
Every song that I wrote told a story of what I was going through. And I knew other people were going through it because I was working clubs. And I'd see women come in, sit down crying, and I'd go talk to them. And they'd tell me what they're going through. Well, I've been through the same thing. So I just wrote it for us women. I didn't say anything too bad about men, did I? I didn't say nothing bad about men. I just wrote for the women.
No, don't come home a-drinkin' with lovin' on your mind.
When she recorded another of her own songs, The Pill, it proved too much for the traditionalists to handle.
I couldn't understand that because it was life. And maybe people were ashamed of life, I don't know. But they made a big deal out of The Pill. And everybody I knew was taking the pill but me. And Lord, I had the kids to prove it. I just couldn't believe they were making such a big deal out of that.
All these years I've stayed at home while you had all your fun. And every year that's gone by, another baby's come. There's gonna be some change.
She just wrote it with just such honesty. And she just told it like it was, didn't she? There wasn't any real anger. She just basically said, this is a line that I'm just not going to cross.
This old maternity dress I've got is going in the garbage.
the clothes I'm wearing from now on won't pick up so much. Women who were struggling to keep a family together and to keep a husband at home and having kids when they were 15 years old, there are a lot of people like that in this world. When they heard those songs, they were so inspired that a woman who was doing all that was making music.
Like Loretta Lynn, Tammy Wynette was also a working mother when she came to Nashville. She was 23, separated from her first husband, and broke.
Well, Tammy, you know, first came to Nashville, you know, with three kids in the backseat of a car, with no money. Had a very hard time, you know, basically went up and down Music Row, trying to see producers or record companies or anybody that would see her. And, you know, when she did get signed, it was still a huge struggle. She used to tell me that in the early days, you know, she had to play, you know, terrible, you know, beer joints. You know, she went there by herself, not with a band, with pickup bands, driving all over. And, you know, there's not a woman in country music that would do that today. There's no way that any of them would go there without, you know, an entourage of, you know, 25 people. Road managers, managers, stylists, hairdressers, makeup people. And you think, you know, that there was Tammy. You know, she would play two or three shows a day sometimes.
Through her turbulent life, Tammy Wynette always stood up for herself. She divorced four times and recorded plenty of assertive songs, like Your Good Girl's Gonna Go Bad. But it would be another hit which saddled her with an image that was far from the truth.
Sometimes it's hard to be a woman, giving all your love to just one man.
Of course, Tammy always had to talk about Stand By Your Man, so I know very well what her feelings were about it. You know, she often said it was a song that took her, you know, 30 minutes to write and 30 years to defend.
Good times, doing things that you don't understand.
It came at a time when everyone was burning their bras and Tammy was saying, I know he's difficult, I know he's a pain in the ass, but stick with it.
Even though he's hard to understand, and if you love him.
I guess the line that bothered people was, if you love him, you'll forgive him. But it's the line after that. It's not about whatever he dishes out you have to take. It's almost like, after all, he's just a man.
They didn't really expect that much of their men, you know, because they always visualized themselves as the strong ones. And Tammy was like that, you know, and certainly the men that she became involved with were not that strong.
Tammy had a very distinctive, amazing voice. And the melody in that song and the way she wails at the end, I mean, just the performance of that song alone, no matter what she was singing about, I think would have made you go, oh my God, you know.